You're listening to the audio production of Go Love Yourself by me, Zachary Levi, published by Harper Horizon and read by me, the author. A note before we begin. Don't forget to download the accompanying enhancement PDF from your audiobook provider. It contains daily prompts for journaling, reflecting, encouraging self-acceptance and personal growth. Every day has a unique set of questions. Check it out. Introduction. If you're looking for a book filled with super unrealistic positivity that only exists in a G-rated world, then close this book now and walk away. This book isn't for you. This book is for people who have been to hell and have the grit to keep moving forward despite their past trauma and struggles. I don't sugarcoat anything. I share everything, the good and the bad. This book is for people who know they have hit rock bottom but still want more out of life. If this sounds like you, you are my people. We are taught not to share our complete selves. So when someone asks us how we're doing, we reply with fine, good, or even great. The honest response should sound a lot more like hanging in there, okay, or not great. We begin to believe the lies that we tell others. And I'm not talking about believing in the sense that we think we are doing fantastic, but instead, we create armor that shields the world from our true feelings. The lies that we live break down our mental wellness. At least, that is what I believe. While my life on the big screen probably seems glamorous, my life is far from that. I am a product of generational trauma and abuse. As a child, I was neglected and never really loved or liked myself. It took me hitting rock bottom to finally get the help I needed so I could heal. I have written this book because I would like to share my healing journey with you. I believe we all have a purpose in life, and I know that we're supposed to learn from one another so we can live out our purpose. I have also learned that mental wellness is part of living and isn't something that can be fixed by reading this book or just talking to a therapist. Mental wellness is a culmination of resources, and being part of your wellness journey is a privilege that I don't take lightly. I want you to learn from my mistakes and realize that you are not alone. There are so many people in the world battling the same struggles and feeling the same mixed bag of emotions you are experiencing. Even though tracing trauma and processing emotions probably feels overwhelming and scary, the journey of mental wellness is worth it. The first step you must take is learning how to love yourself. And that's what I'm sharing with you, how I learned to love myself. Each day, I encourage you to read one entry and respond to the prompts. You can respond verbally to yourself, write answers in a journal, or take notes on an app. I want to preface this with reiterating, this isn't some book proclaiming to fix all of your problems. But it is a resource that will help you kick off or continue your mental wellness journey. Day one, reacting versus responding. It had been 5 years since my TV show Chuck had been canceled by NBC. I'd worked steadily since, but my phone wasn't ringing off the hook with major offers. I was secretly afraid that my run as an actor was all but finished. On top of that, while most of my friends were off getting hitched and settling down, my marriage had imploded, just like every other relationship I'd ever had. I was closing in on 37, alone, with no family. I'd packed my entire life into a U-Haul and moved to Austin from Los Angeles with big dreams that were going to change my life, dreams that had given me a newfound sense of mission and purpose. But now I was beginning to question whether I'd made a terrible mistake. What I can say, in hindsight, is that I was suffering from a tremendous amount of anxiety at the time. I had, in fact, been wrestling with anxiety and depression and fear and self-loathing my entire life. I just hadn't known it. I 100% did not think of myself as someone with serious mental health issues. I didn't know what anxiety and depression really were, at least not from a clinical point of view. When I finally did learn the depths of their meaning, it was a revelation. Wait a minute. If this is what anxiety is, then this is what I've been feeling almost every waking moment for most of my life. Up until that summer, I'd always managed to white-knuckle my way through my problems. self-medicating and finding ways to keep myself propped up without ever realizing how emotionally fragile I was. And when it came to the subject of my own mental health, I was functionally illiterate. Coming to terms with the full scope of my ignorance about mental health was upsetting for me. I'm a person who's always prided myself on my ability to tackle complex problems and figure them out. One of my favorite books as a kid was this oversized picture book called The Way Things Work. It had page after page of these fun cross-section illustrations showing you, this is how a pulley works, and this is how an elevator works. I used to sit and look through it for hours. I think I've always had more of an engineer's brain. That brain has helped me many times in my career, having the ability to analyze how the business of Hollywood operates, taking the system apart to figure out the best way to navigate it. But that same mind was completely flummoxed when it came to understanding how its own inner mechanisms functioned. I didn't understand the cause and effect between the traumas I'd experienced as a child and the behaviors I was wrestling with as an adult. I didn't understand that so much of my insecurity came from outsourcing my sense of self-worth to forces beyond my control. I didn't understand that the reason my marriage had ended wasn't because I'd failed, but because I was broken. Day 2, mental well-being. Taking care of your mind should be no more embarrassing than taking care of your teeth. We all need to be proactive, to brush and floss our minds, to root out the lies we tell ourselves and the bad programming that drives so much of our behavior. We don't. We do the opposite. We pretend and project out to the world that I'm great, and we're great, and everything's fine. But it's not always fine. And because we refuse to admit that, we do nothing. And all of a sudden, what started out as a little cavity is now in need of a root canal. Society places a terrible stigma on mental illness. We judge people for it in ways that we never would for the other kinds of health issues. If you tell someone you're physically ill, they say, oh gosh, I'm so sorry. What's the matter? Talk to me. There's no stigma attached to it. From cancer to the common cold, people want to make sure you're okay. But when you swap out physical illness with mental illness, then people seem to start pondering, well, how unstable is this person? Is it time for a straitjacket and a rubber room? Which makes us ashamed to talk about it. We shouldn't be, but we are. And I was, like so many other people. Trauma bends our minds into incorrect thinking patterns, so much so that we can barely see or think our way around them. It took me a long time to recognize how much help and healing I needed. Day 3. Get help. If you're feeling overwhelmed, run down, fearful, stressed out, anxious, depressed, alone, or anything that may be robbing you of your peace or your joy, talk to someone. Do not believe the lie that you are going through this alone, because you aren't. You could be sitting next to someone right this second who struggles with the same issues that you do. Maybe that person can help you. We are all in this together. From the minute we come into this world, even though we're not aware of it, we're trying to feel that we belong, that we matter. We look to our parents and our friends and our family and our school and our society, and we ask them, who am I? Do I have worth in this world? Do I have purpose in this life? The answer, without question, is yes, you do. Unfortunately, most of the time, we don't hear that answer. Unfortunately, too many of us have parents who don't make us feel as if we belong. Unfortunately, we belong to a society that prioritizes all the wrong things. Things like money and fame and attractiveness and overall status, forcing us to judge ourselves against all the wrong standards, standards by which we always come up short. So then we find ourselves alone in the darkness where the voices come for us and tell us how stupid and ugly and worthless we are. But it's a lie. It's a fucking lie. You belong here simply because you are here. God created every single one of us with our own inherent worth and value and dignity. Mental illness is the lie that undermines that truth. In fact, not only is it a lie, it's a lie that begets more lies in turn, as lies often do. One of the most insidious of those lies is that your problems are yours alone. Because you've never been inside someone else's head to feel the pain they feel, you're convinced that you're the only person suffering like this, that you're the only person who has ever suffered like this, which is why you can be surrounded by friends and family telling you it's okay and still feel so horribly alone. It's also why the situation feels so hopeless. Why even ask for help when nobody could possibly help you? Because if you're the only one with this problem, what are the chances of doctors ever diagnosing and treating you? You're so broken that no one will ever be able to find the cure. Of course, none of that is true. There are millions of people who hurt the same way that you hurt. There are thousands of doctors and therapists who understand how to treat you and how to help you. But you can't see that because the thing you're sick with comes with the absence of hope, an absence of faith, the inability to see yourself and your life clearly. Day 4. Stuck. When in a state of major turmoil, I fall into this place where the minutiae of life will bury me. I'll have a hard time making decisions, even about the smallest things. I think there are two broad categories of anxious people: those who are anxious about things they can't control, and those who are anxious about things they can. With major events outside my control, such as getting hit by a truck on the freeway, I've always had a much easier time being like, well, okay, it is what it is. I've always been far more anxious about what I can control. I get stuck trying to figure out the perfect way to do the thing, and I think, don't fuck this up, don't fuck this up, don't fuck this up. The thing has to be perfect, because if a thing is not perfect, it's a failure, and failures don't receive love. And why do I think this way? Because that's the way I was programmed as a kid by my parents. Your childhood is baggage that you're forced to carry around your entire life. That's why it's important to get help with your baggage. I am lucky to have friends who care about me. When everything feels meaningless, they remind me, it's okay. Don't let yourself stay stuck. Don't allow yourself to believe that failure is your final destination. You're gonna fuck up, but you can learn from those mistakes. You can take control and get unstuck. Day 5, be open. Even though our knowledge of the human mind and body has increased 1,000-fold over time, and
we hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.